I have the honor to introduce Jennifer Minella, who's our first keynote speaker. I got to know, well, I've known Jennifer for more than 5 years on Twitter. I never met her in person until the beginning of this year when she joined the IC Square board. And I got to know her as a very energetic, just generally nice person. And I thought the Brucon audience deserved her presence here. So please join me in welcoming Jennifer.
Thanks, Wim. Ooh, that's loud. That was a very generous introduction. I have to hook my laptop up here very quickly, but I think we all have a burning question that needs to be answered here. Wim, buddy.
He's not single.
No, my husband's here. Where is he? He's somewhere here.
The one
what happened to your hair there last night?
I don't know what happened exactly, but we were drinking, and around 3 a.m. I decided to get my head shaved.
It's Brucon. Did
you do that yourself?
No. There was a very nice guy that actually knew what he was doing.
Okay, yeah, it's pretty even. That explains why he can't unlock his iPhone. So these two guys are over here, they don't know how to turn my laptop on, so they're touching it lightly and then pulling their hands back like this, like, it's not working. I didn't break it. It's over here.
It's hidden.
It's hidden. Are these on? Okay. Well, since they broke my laptop. So I'm JJ. I'm JJX on Twitter. You guys that are way up there, did somebody warn you about how I do talks? Is that why you're up there? Do you know this? Were you warned? Yes? No? Or you just like to hide in the back? You're those people. I know those people. I know your people too. You guys in the front? Yeah, I know you too. All right. You want to go for a second? Do you have any fun drug stories to share from last night? All right, good deal. So that's not the right one. How many engineers does it take? That still doesn't look good. I'll let you guys work on that for a minute. Can you work on that? Can you fix that? Is that something you can do?
Sorry. It's projecting. It's fine.
Oh, it's not. The whole thing's not on there.
Okay, yeah.
Let me see if this works for me too.
I'm going to plug it in again.
I see that. Good. It's function of 4.
And if you, is it PowerPoint?
Mm-hmm.
Or do we try projection on the, yeah. No, it's switching back.
Wim, I think whoever got a hold of your phone got a hold of my laptop here. Yeah, if you want to try and extend and switch, that's fine. I can, you know, we can make do. That's okay. Beautiful. Look at you. Ta-da. Thank you. Just have to be smarter than the PowerPoint. So if you have come to one of my sessions before in the past, you're probably used to a little bit more technical stuff, something on wireless, network security, things like that. This is completely different. Wim said, we want you to do something fun and different. And I said, yes. And that was, I don't know, a year ago. So then like a few months ago, I'm thinking, wow, what kind of fun and different things can we do? So, the InfoSec life lessons from Dr. Seuss. Um, Well, there's a little Dr. Seuss, and there's a little bit of lessons in here for everybody. So maybe I'm going to tell you some things you don't want to hear. Maybe I'm going to tell you some things you've already heard 10 times. We're going to see. This is very participatory. I'm going to stand right here. It's going to be one of these days. Okay. So I'm going to start off with a quote that I really, really like, and this is one that's been used for a long time for so many different things, and that's that a journey of 1,000 miles begins with a single step. And I know it's overused, but it's so true because it's so simple. And it's attributed to an ancient Chinese philosopher, Lao Tzu. And I know what some of you guys are thinking. That can't be right because nobody else uses miles. Ancient China didn't have miles, I know. But this is just one of the translations. So the concept is that anytime you're doing anything, it does. It starts with a single step, one little step at a time. My dad used to tell me when I didn't want to do something, he would say, well, you're never going to finish it if you never start it. So today's conversation is about a challenge to start something a little bit different. And the different part is addressing what I perceive and what several other people in our industry perceive to be a lot of issues we have going on. So I love this because anytime we go to a security conference, everybody rants about something at some point, right? Somebody's on a soapbox somewhere talking about something, and then there are 5 other people that are kind of ranting about the same thing. And that's great. But I'm kind of a problem solver. If you're going to rant to me about something, I'm going to come back and try to figure out a way to help you solve that. So here we go. What's wrong with our industry? I think this is kind of hard to pin down because if I come and ask you and I come and ask you and I come and ask you, you're each going to tell me something different, right? Let me ask this. How many of you guys, I come from the networking side, infrastructure, wireless, and security. How many of you guys are on networking? Only like a dozen. Wow. Okay, what about application, AppSec? What about used to be? Okay. Sure. What about the application side? Development, security? And the rest of you people? Do we have auditors? No. Phew. That's good. What do the rest of you guys do? What do you do? What do you do?
I'm a student.
A student. What are you studying?
Applied informatics.
Okay. Ooh. I read an article about that. What do you do? Okay, student engineering. A lot of students here. That is fantastic. Okay, so what do the rest of you people do? I know what you do. And that's why I didn't go out with you last night. I know what you do. That would not look good on me. What do you do? Are you a student? A student. The student sat up front. Y'all should learn from these people. No, I know better. So the point is that whether you're a security manager or you're a business manager or you're in engineering or you're an AppSec, whatever you are, you have your own list of things. So these are some of the things that I've kind of gathered from different sources here. We don't have enough people. Our developers aren't building security in the products. Vendors are sacrificing security. Our roles are too specialized. Our roles are too broad. There's not enough diversity. We suck at information sharing. Everybody wants to be a rock star. We have too many hats. My toaster's broken. Whatever. We have all of these different things. And as if we don't come up with enough of these on our own, our industry media is really good at helping us, aren't they? I love this article. These are recent ones. So the cybersecurity hiring crisis. Rockstars, anger, and the billion-dollar problem from ZDNet, Violet Blue. It's true. I'm not picking on her because it's not true. This is true, but they get very sensationalized, especially in mainstream media, so we're not even going to go there. I picked this one because I had a couple quotes from people that I really liked here. If you guys know James Arlen, I found the one picture in the world of him smiling, so I wanted to share it with you all. There he is. But he's very smart, so he said something good here. We have almost a 500,000 shortage of people, a shortage of 500,000 people in our industry, and it's growing. And so he says, this is literally the billion-dollar question, how do we solve this? And I put a billion up there because that's a lot of zeros, that's 9 zeros, and I wanted to count that out. 9 zeros is enough for me to pay attention to something. Probably enough for you to pay attention to it, too. Hoff, my brother from another mother almost down under, said something here that the industry needs to grow up. And I really can't agree with that more. And really, that is what this time in the next 40 or so minutes is about. How are we going to grow up? How are we going to upgrade our industry? And what do we do for that? The other one, oh goodness, Home Depot. So the Home Depot hack, as you see here, it says that they're depicting C-level security before their breach. C-level here doesn't mean C-level like executive level. They mean like not a grade of A, not a grade of B, but a grade of C. And some of the editors from the magazines might argue that this is more of an F. But, you know, this is just one of the breaches we've had. So we had Goodwill, Neiman Marcus, P.F. Chang's, Target, and I think as of last month, Target had already spent $146 million out of pocket, not including what their insurance covered, addressing their breach. So to put this in perspective, Home Depot in the U.S. is our fourth largest retailer, much bigger than Target. Much bigger. And they think that this breach might have been happening for, I think, 6 months. Is that what we're up to now, possibly? Who knows how much money they're going to spend? Oh, here's another one. Cybersecurity is a hiring crisis, a troubling trajectory. Do you see what I did there with the little picture? You like that? So here, what they're saying is, it's bad and it's getting worse. And then in this second paragraph at the end, it says, calling it a crisis seems a gross underestimation of the problem. Hoff again here says, and I'm going to read this one to you because we don't want to miss any of these words. The result of all this is increased risk, more incidents, decreased readiness, less resilience, demoralized or burned out employees, an echo chamber of talk with little action, and a general inability to effect positive change on the behalf of those we protect. I don't know what you think when you read this. Hoff's a smart guy. I think we're screwed. What do we do? Is this our problem? I'm imagining that several of you are thinking, you're sitting here, you're students, you're in engineering, we're not going to go into there. You're this is a problem, hiring problem, personnel problem. I don't even know. That's not really my job. I don't even know that I care. You're probably sitting there going, JJ, I don't really care. This does not affect me right now. Well, I think we're smart people. I think if we don't have the expertise to do this, we will find it. I think if you think it's not your job, you're wrong. It is. And I think if you're sitting right here right now and you think you don't care, you better start caring. This is huge. This is our industry and our lives. You might be comfortable right now. How long is that going to last if we don't fix some of this stuff? So I'm going to talk to you about a few things. There are five words you're going to hear a few times today. Life, people, leadership, culture, and industry. Now, this isn't the, you know, the frou-frou trust fall off of the balcony thing unless Wim passes out in the next hour or so. I'm watching you. So, this says we need to work on the industry. What does that mean? So, there's a business consultant, his name is Brian, who introduced this concept to me in the terms of our business as a company. And this really extends out to the industry. So you talk about and you think about working in the business and then working on the business. And the difference between those two things is working in the business is what you normally do with your daily task and your kind of tactical things you're doing, marking things off of your checklist. When you manage a business and you're in charge of running that business and feeding all of your employees and feeding yourself, what you have to start to do is work on your business. And this is the same thing with working on the industry. So this is more about stepping back, getting out of the forest, and don't look at the trees. When you're working in the business or in the industry, you're in your trees. When you're working on it, you step back, you zoom out, and you see the whole forest. And then you start to figure out, where are we in this forest? Not which tree am I going to cut down that's right in front of me. Where am I in the forest? Where am I going? How do we get there? How do we overcome the obstacles on the way? And then plan for things that we don't expect. So I think we're at a point right now where we need to do that. Most of the things that you see when you go to conferences are about working in the industry, right? Which MDM solution is going to best secure the applications on my OSs? How do I secure my routers? How do cryptographic key exchanges work? That's in the industry, and we need that. Don't stay out drinking so late that you don't make it to those sessions. That stuff's very important. We have a lot of it. We have a lot of great speakers. This is a key component of us maintaining our momentum. But what we're missing and what we have to solve is the working on the industry. How do we take a step back and figure out how we help each other and what we can do to fix these problems and move our industry forward? So we're going to do a little poll really quickly. I need somebody just very quickly that can stand here and help me because I can't multitask, I'm blonde, that's good with numbers and percentages. Do I have somebody that can do numbers and percentages? Oh, you guys suck. You failed math. Once or twice? Just once. Good, you can do it. Come here. This is super easy. All right, so here's what I'm going to do. And I'm going to run through these four slides. I'm going to run through them two times, since there may be some language barriers here, being that I'm all U.S. Southern and everything. All right, you're good right there. You don't have to go anywhere. So I'm going to show you four slides. They're kind of four characteristics. Specifically, they're characters from Dr. Seuss. And I want you to think about each one of those four, and then we're going to go back to them very quickly, and I want you to raise your hand on the second trip with the one that you kind of identify with. Like, this is how I feel. All right, ready? So, number one is the evil Grinch. I'm convinced the world sucks in general. I'm not included or consulted in most decisions that affect me. I refuse to be controlled by others, and I pretty much play by my own rules. So, if you've seen the Grinch or read the Grinch, this would be the Grinch before the whole enlightened Christmas thing. This is the evil Grinch, okay? Number two is the curmudgeonly Lorax. Somehow, I usually draw the short stick, often stuck with managers that are inexperienced or unwilling to give me the resources needed. I've seen it all, and it makes me skeptical. I've learned that most things are a lost cause and not worth my time and energy to fix. Now, there's no right or wrong answer here either, you guys. Number three is the star Sneech. I work hard, I'm told by my managers I'm good at my job, but I often feel limited by others' lack of intelligence, experience, or drive. I've figured out that knowledge is power, I strive to be the best at what I do, and I also jump in and help others whenever I can. What's so funny? You don't like my star Sneech? Would you be happier if I read you the whole book? I have it. No, okay. Just checking. I'm here for you guys. I'm here for you guys. Okay. Then the team thing. I can't complain. I'm lucky to work with a great team. We share goals and values. We do whatever we can. And we win because of that. Those are the four. All right. Is everybody locked in your number mentally? I'm going to go back through them. Hold your hands. This is where you come in. So, no, that's okay. Here's all you have to do. It's very easy. It's really hard for you to screw this up. I'm sure you'll find a way, though. When they raise their... I'm kidding. Oh, I have another one. I knew you were going to do that. And I actually... No, really. You see? I had a feeling somebody was going to eat my index card. I woke up this morning. I said, someone's going to eat my index card. Okay, so this is all you need to do. We're going to go through these very quickly. 1, 2, 3, 4. People are going to raise their hands, right? That's what we're going to do. And you're just going to scribble down ishy percentages of how many for each of those four. They don't need to add up to 100, but if they do, that would probably be pretty good. I'm trying to set reasonable boundaries. Let's work within a margin of error of maybe 12. Okay, ready? Are you paying attention to your friends here? Okay. Yeah, you can stand up. Ready? Okay, number one. The evil Grinch. Who feels like this? Couple of you guys. All right, you getting this? Okay, and you can scribble whatever you want to down there. Number two, the curmudgeonly Lorax. How many of this is you guys? I said we were going to go fast, but I have to make sure he's keeping up with us here. Okay, number three, the Star Sneech. Hard workers out there. That's most of you guys. You're doing a great job. Number four, the Team Thing. Good. Okay, so like I said, there's no right or wrong answer here. I'm going to explain what this comes from and what it means a little bit later. I'm going to take this paper before he eats it.
Not done yet.
Oh. Thank you. No, that's my favorite pen in the whole world. Thank you very much. Give him a round of applause. He actually did it right. We're so proud of you. You set the expectation low and you'll always exceed it, right? See, Wim's not paying enough attention for me to pick on him, so sorry, you're my next victim. Sure, do that. Oh. So I have a philosophy about life leadership. And I know this is like kumbaya, hug a bear, hug a tree kind of thing. But the truth is that there are really, in my mind, a couple kinds of leadership. What's so funny, Wim? No, you definitely, you know what? Yes, every day is a day that you will be remembered. It's just not what you would want to show your kids. Yes, because we're going to remember this. And we're going to remember that iPhone and something will happen tonight that everybody will remember, and I'll make sure of it. So I have a philosophy, and I'm sure somebody else has this philosophy, but it came to me one day, accidentally during a rant, which we all do, about leadership stuff. And I said, well, there's life leadership, and then there's thought leadership. So what's the difference? Thought leadership is about working in the industry. These are the really smart people that are doing really great things, maybe very specific within their field or specific piece of the industry. And then there's life leadership, and life leadership has to do with those five things: life, people, leadership, culture, and industry, in our case, industry. How those things are connected is that if you want to upgrade something, in this case, our industry, it requires an upgrade of culture. And this isn't culture of like a geographic culture. This is how we interact with each other as people, as a group, as a whole. And we could spend an hour talking about just that. It's pretty interesting. Culture upgrades happen with good leadership. Good leadership happens with people and enabling people. And your ability to enable people happens with starting with your own life. So life, people, leadership, culture, industry, they're not necessarily linear. They're all related and kind of interdependent. So when we talk about how we're working on the industry right now, in my mind, it starts with leadership. You have to have all these pieces, but it starts with leadership. So the thought leadership versus the life leadership is what I think we're missing, because how do we captivate? If we're saying, for all of you guys that are students, for all of us that are not students, especially in the States, we're saying, God, we just do not have enough people interested in technology. Not just tech, everybody likes gadgety stuff, but really digging into it. How do we get these people? Well, you know what? Who the hell wants to go into a field where everybody is miserable and grumpy and bitchy and ranting all the time? Who wants to do that? No kid wakes up and goes, ooh, I want to do that when I grow up. You look like you're miserable every day. Not that we're all miserable every day. But it comes from enabling people. And I'm going to talk about enabling people in a little bit later. So I'll tell you why suddenly this is my little soapbox and why I want to share this with you. I was always, in most of my professional career, I was striving for being the star snitch, right? Number three, the star snitch. And I really thought that if I worked really hard and I did all of the hard work and learned everything, that I would help enable the organization and other people by having all the answers and being able to help them all the time. That's what we get paid to do. You figure it out, and then when I come to you, you tell me how to do it, or you do it for me. That's extremely taxing, but it was working really well for a long time. So about 10 years ago, when I moved into the engineering side on the networking infrastructure, it was great. I had all the certifications, I had all the training, I had all the experience working with all kinds of different organizations and agencies. It was fantastic. And then we started to grow, and then suddenly there were more of me's. And apparently, I was supposed to be managing those other engineers. A couple little problems with that. I didn't know how to manage anybody. I had never been managed. And when I thought I had it figured out, I realized I really, really, really sucked at it. So I kind of had a moment one day where I woke up and I said, I hate going to work. I'd never thought that before. I hate going to work. We spend a lot of time at work. That's a really crappy feeling to have. I hate going to work. I want to find something else to do. And so I didn't really know what to do, so I pulled my little team into the conference room and I shut the door, almost in tears, and I said, I hate coming to work. And if technically I'm your boss, you probably really, really, really hate coming to work. Is that true? And they didn't want to tell me at first, but then eventually they were kind of like, yeah, it kind of sucks. And I said, well, how about we sit here and we fix this? Now, it's not something you fix in a day. It's something you fix for me over a few years. So that was more than a year ago, almost 2 years ago. But that was the first turning point where I said, wow, my job now is to help other people. And so that's why I'm here. Here's where we get into the lessons from Dr. Seuss, our good friend Theodore. Now, I don't know how many of you guys know this, but Dr. Seuss was a political cartoonist before he wrote children's books. Did you guys know that? A couple of you? Okay. So it's pretty interesting because if you look at his children's books, pretty much everything has some political undertone to it, if you dig in. Most of them also have a little bit of a life lesson or leadership story hidden in there too, some more than others. So our first one, lessons from the Zacks. Live demo time. This is either going to be fantastic or it's going to fail fantastically. I need two volunteers, preferably two that do not know each other. You guys are horrible. Wake up. Don't make me start to come find you. All right, you, come on up here. And you, do you guys know each other? Okay, fair enough. Yeah, good luck getting through there. Now, Bim. Wim, I want you to find anybody in the audience that you know and like, and preferably they like you back. Not in the funny way like, just somebody that you could work well with. And I want you to find that person and bring them up here with you. Where's your husband? He's probably hiding. Is he here? If he is here, he just ducked down behind something. I don't know. He's probably eating. That's what he does. Can we what? Say the name? My husband. Yes. His name is Dave. I don't know if he likes me, but I like it. Which one? That guy. All right, Jacob, come on up here. All right, so you two come over here. Oh, yeah. I bet you haven't slept, so this is going to be fun. All right.
I
slept for 2 hours.
2 hours. Good. Good job. Good job. That's more than normal. Wait, which way is north?
What?
Anybody know?
That way.
That way. That works for me. We'll make it up. That's going to be north. I always get confused. Are penguins in the North Pole or South Pole? No, it's okay. They're in the South Pole? Okay. You seem to know a lot about penguins. You come here too. You just have to stand right here. Okay. I have to tell them something. So I'm going to turn the microphone off for a moment. Are you guys cool? Can you entertain yourself for maybe 20 seconds? Great. Hell gave him a microphone. Don't do that. No, 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 no. That's a bad idea. Always a bad idea. Okay. I don't know what's gonna go on here. I'm gonna move out of the way just in case something weird happens. So you're the penguin and you're doing a great job being a penguin. You're just standing there so that we know that that's south. I'm blonde, I get confused easily. I don't think he actually speaks English and he has no clue what's going on, but I told him to head towards you, so I think he's good with that. Okay, so instead of reading you the story of the Zacks, I'm gonna show you the story of the Zacks. Okay, Zacks. Start going. So the southbound Zacks is going to walk, and they have to walk in their specific line. And the northbound Zacks is heading north in the same line. They're not allowed to deviate from their line. So these guys just got in the middle, and then they're going to stand there. That's fine. Yeah, don't start punching each other or anything. That's really mean. So you did a great job. I need you for audit purposes in a moment, so if you can just step over there. Okay, you remember what I told you?
No.
I know you speak English. If you fail at this, it's your own doing. Okay. All right, the penguin's down there. All right, Zacks, go for it. What did I tell you? Perfect. So, okay. So audit purposes, what I told the first group was, you're a North Zacks, you're a South Zacks, you have to stay in the same line, you're gonna meet in the middle, and then you probably can't go any further, and that would be okay. Is that what I told you guys?
Yes.
Yep.
Okay, so what I told these guys was, the same thing, you're North, you're South, you're gonna meet in the middle, and then you're not gonna be able to go any further. But I want you to figure it out. Is that what I told you guys?
Yep.
Yes.
Yes. Do whatever you have to do and figure it out. So, thank you very much. You can sit down. Be the penguin too. You did great. So the lesson here is that I see this all the time as a consultant, and you're not going to give them a round of applause? Wim just crawled through his legs and that got nothing from you guys. Wake up. Well, that's a different story. So the point here is what this picture is from is the two Zachs that met in the middle, and then they refused to move. They were so stubborn. They just stood there like this, and the world built around them. So I love this because it reminds me of working as a consultant in the IT industry, especially in security. So many times what I see is, especially one of these persons or Zaxes, is a security person, and another is not a security person. Having come from both sides of that, I see both points of view, but a lot of times we kind of lock horns in the middle like this. Do you guys see that? You're pretty adamant about something, and somebody else is pretty adamant about something else, and you can't come to an agreement on it. So when do you let go of that? When do you stop being stubborn? Well, the next story gives a little bit of a contrast to that. But the point about the Zacks is that we have to communicate and collaborate. There is a, I don't know if this would translate this very well into everything, but there's a concept about a circle of trust. So if your people that you're working with, whether they're your coworkers or your customers, your bosses, whatever, are within your circle of trust, and that's why I ask Wim, please pick somebody that you're comfortable with, somebody that you like that's in your circle of trust, you're gonna get things done. If you're those first Zacks, or the penguin over there, you just kind of lock horns, and then everybody else just moves around you and thinks that you're just a stubborn ass. So, a little bit of a contrast from that story is the story about Horton. Is everybody familiar with Horton the elephant? Seeing this picture on the big screen just reminded me that my husband has a really good joke about elephant in a tree. So if you see him at the conference in the next couple of days, please ask him about his really fantastic joke with the elephant in the tree. All right, so Horton the elephant, the story goes that he's splashing in the pool and having fun, and he's got these big elephant ears, of course, because he's an elephant, and he hears something crying out for help, like a little voice crying out for help. And he walks around, he figures out what this thing is, and he decides that there must be people on this little thing because he can hear them talking. And these people are so little, they're on this little tiny speck of dust, but he really wants to help them. So he spends all of his time protecting them. "I'll help you," said Horton, "but who are you, where?" And Horton walked, worrying almost an hour. "Should I put this speck down?" Horton thought with alarm. "If I do, these small persons may come to great harm. I can't put it down, and I won't. After all, a person's a person, no matter how small." So Horton sticks by his guns here. And all of the other creatures in the forest think he's crazy. I don't know why there are monkeys and kangaroos in this forest, but there are. And they think that he's crazy. So they decided that he's crazy, and they're taking the speck of dust away, and they're hunting Horton, and they're trying to cage him. It gets really graphic. There's Bezel nut oil. They're going to boil them in. I didn't want to show you guys that. It's traumatizing. But Horton really sticks by his guns, and he talks to these, it's Whoville, and he talks to these Whos, and he says, "Come on, Whos, make noise, make everybody hear you. Their ears aren't as big as mine." And so finally he gets them all to make all this noise, and eventually the silly kangaroo and these really freaky looking monkeys finally go, "Oh yeah, there are little people down on this little tiny speck of dust." And then everybody lives happily ever after, because that's how this book ends. So the contrast here is that unlike the Zacks, where they just hit this point where they're really stubborn, and they're just going to stand there, and they're not going to give up, they're not going to cooperate, they're not going to talk, there is a point in time, there are points in time, where we have to identify what is really important to us. What are our values, our core values, our noble causes, our morals, our beliefs, and when do we stick by them? When do we stand up? Stand up for whomever. Stand up for yourself. Stand up for a colleague or a coworker. Say, "Bless you." When do we do that? That's a fine line between being that stubborn ass Zacks and being somebody that's sticking by their values and their morals. Lessons from Yertle the Turtle. This is a short one because this one's so obvious. So Yertle the Turtle, but Yertle the Turtle King, actually, he's the king of the turtles. decides that he can rule over everything that he can see. So to see more stuff, he starts stacking up turtles, his little turtle minions. And then he starts climbing on top of them. Well, he starts with 9 turtles. And I think he saw a goat or something, maybe a horse. And then he could kind of see trees, and he thought, well, no, I want to see past all of that stuff. So he kept stacking the turtles up, and he kept crawling on top of them. And they were complaining, because that's heavy, right? How many turtles can you really stack up before your back hurts, your little turtle shell? So he keeps going, and he keeps going, and keeps going. And the short version of the story is that the turtles at the bottom are kind of going, hey, what about us? You know, we know you're doing great things up there, but what about us? You know, who's taking care of us? And why are we being used? They don't use the word, but why are we being used? So the story here is really about enablement for me. Would you consider Yertle the turtle a leader? You guys that are still in school, is that a leader to you? Somebody that climbs on top of other turtles or people? That would be weird too. I've seen some cool circus stuff like that. No, that's not a leader. That's somebody that's just scratching and climbing and clawing their way up at the expense of other people, which is something that we see way too often in this industry. I'm gonna come back to that later. Oh my goodness, this one's my favorite. This is kind of your bonus. So if you guys have seen the Sneetches, some of them had little stars on their belly. So cute, like a Care Bear. And then some of them didn't. So the short version here is that the ones that had the stars on there were like, ooh, we're cool, we got stars, we're not hanging out with you people that don't have stars. You don't have a star, Wim. You ain't hanging out with me. You're not cool. I'm gonna eat my weenies and not talk to you. So they had the star-bellied Sneetches and the plain-bellied Sneetches. And then this guy comes into town, and he has this machine that can take off or put on stars. So they start doing that all day long until nobody knows what's going on, and they're all completely confused, and it reminded me of one thing and one thing only. And somebody just said it. How do you make this work? I'm obviously too stupid to use a laptop. Maybe we can pretend. Have you guys seen this video? I'm gonna just hope that you have. No? Oh my God. All right, hang on. Give me 3 seconds here. All right. I got news for you, it's not gonna work. All right, so what this video is, it's a spoof by Javad that is C-I-S-S-P, and it's about how cool people with C-I-S-S-P are. I love this video. It's hilarious. It's funny. Look it up. But it reminded me of everybody with their certifications. Now, yes, I'm on the board of ISC Squared, as is Wim. So we obviously feel a certain way about this. We think that there's value there, and we want to contribute to that value. But my God, I feel like every conference we go to, there's like panels. I've sat on several of them. Are certifications still valid? Are they giving us value? Is the CISSP going down in flames? Certifications are rising from the ashes like a phoenix. I don't know. All kinds of stupid stuff. So this reminded me of the CISSP certification and everybody with their little stars being CISSP or not CISSP. So that was your bonus piece there. All right, here's the point where I'm gonna tell you some things maybe you don't wanna hear, but whatever. I mentioned the life, people, leadership, culture, industry, and I think those are key pieces. If we're starting with ourselves, then what does this mean? Why is this important? I think this is important because what I'm getting at in this message is that if we all try to be rock stars, we will fail as an industry. We will never have any music. We will never have any bands. And I think this is an important message. It doesn't matter how many conferences you speak at. It doesn't matter how many CTFs you won. Great, you're smart. Can you help other people do it? Can you find somebody else that wants to learn? Somebody coming out of school? Maybe somebody that's even younger? Maybe somebody that's switching careers? Maybe somebody that's been in this career and just not been very good at it for a while? Can you find that person and help them do what you're doing? It's great if they think you're a rock star, that's fine. But our purpose in life is not to convince everybody that we're smarter than they are. And yet I walk around at these conferences and I feel like that's what we're doing. I don't think we have anything to prove. I know when somebody's presenting somewhere they're smart. I know they know what they're doing. Few exceptions sometimes. I've also seen times where somebody presented something and I thought, my God, that was something we knew about 6 years ago and it was fixed. But maybe they were kids. I say kids because I feel old at this point in my life. They were younger people, younger than I am. They were just getting into the industry and they were using whatever resources they had available and that was what they came up with. And they still fixed it. Well, God bless them. Who cares that we didn't need it anymore? They took the initiative to figure that out. So those are the kind of people you seek them out and you see if you can help them. I see a lot of you looking at me like, I'm putting my CFP into RSA tomorrow. Oh, it's today. I'm putting my CFP into RSA today. So what happens if we don't start fixing some of these things? Like Hoff said, increased risk, more incidents, decreased readiness, less resilience, demoralized and burned out workers. And I love the last sentence. Inability to affect positive change on the behalf of those we protect. Because that's why we're here, right? Ultimately, are you here to win a CTF? Or are you here to get skills and share knowledge to help you and your colleagues and our industry, and ultimately, whoever you're going to protect? I think that's why we're here. And I think we need to remember that. So the point in this is that things don't change on their own. I can't make this change. All I can do is plant a little seed, an idea, and hope that you'll think about this. I can't even ask for action at this point, other than for you to think about it. Especially as you walk around this conference the next couple of days, this is a great opportunity to start thinking about this. How can I help somebody else? What does leadership really mean? What is Wim doing on his phone? Are you? Did you get your phone unlocked? No. There are so many stories there. So with that, I'm going to wrap up a few minutes early, and I'm going to say to everybody, things don't change unless you change them. You can't wait for somebody else to do something. This is your industry or an industry that you're coming into. And how well we do individually, how well we do as a group, how well we do as a culture, and how well we do collaborating and communicating with one another affects our industry as a whole. I don't think that the people that attack us are smarter than we are. I don't think they have more resources than we do, maybe more time sometimes. I don't think they're better equipped. I don't think they care more about anything. But I think we lack this. We just lack something fundamental. These life lessons, these lessons in leadership, enabling other people. At the beginning of this session, we had our assistant here who wrote down percentages for us. So we asked 1, 2, 3, and 4, and these are the percentages. I don't have any clue why you scribbled out 40 twice and then wrote the same thing down 2 more times, but that's okay. It's what? It's 45? Oh, the first one, I see. Okay, good job. You were trying to make him add them. All right, so we had in this group, congratulations, Only 3%, number one, that was the evil Grinch. 7%, number two, that was the curmudgeonly Lorax. I will tell you that in most places in the United States, that number is much, much higher. 40%, number three, the star Sneech. And 50% at number four, the team thing. I want to tell you congratulations on those numbers, because one of the things that I've learned over the past couple of years, and when I say learned, I mean when I realized how badly I sucked at managing people, and that I didn't even have a clue what leadership was about, I did everything I could and found everybody I could and every resource to try to fix that and learn more. So am I an expert? No. But I put a lot of work into this. And a lot of the resources that I've read, there's a concept about tribal leadership, one of my favorite books. So there's a concept about tribal leaderships and cultures. Again, tribes, not tribes in the way you think of, but just a group of people. Personal, professional, any group of people. And in that, the idea is that actually there are five groups, but I put four and five together. So the normal numbers are something more like 23% in that number four category. And you guys have about doubled that. So the idea is that you don't jump through culture. So one, two, three, and four are actually linear. And it has to do with how you deal with other people, how you talk to them, actually specifically about language, and you think about things. So one, two, three, and four, there's no right or wrong answer here. It doesn't mean you're bad if you're one or two. It just means that if you want to start affecting change, you have a little bit more work to do. You have one more extra little step to do. Because you don't start thinking about things this way until you get to the end of three and the beginning of four. So those of you that are at the end of three and the beginning of four, congratulations. You are well on your way. So with that, you guys have a great couple of days ahead of you. I'm going to just tell you that my opening statement was that even the longest journey, if we take miles out of it, starts with a single step. This has been a long journey for me, but this is my first big single step. So as you walk through the conference, this one, future conferences, as you go back to work next week, my question for all of you, and really my challenge for each of you, is to start thinking about this and figure out what is going to be your first step. With that, I'd like to thank you all so much for spending time with me today, and I will see you in the next couple days.